item is the adoption of the agenda. Most recent agenda is before you. Are there any corrections or action on the agenda?
Make a motion to adopt the agenda as presented.
Second?
Second.
There's a motion and a second to adopt the agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say no. That motion is adopted. For our dates to remember, we have on November 15th and 17th, fourth and fifth grade parent-teacher conferences from 3:30 to 6:45. November 21st and 22nd, kindergarten first grade parent-teacher conferences from 3:30 to 6:45. November 23rd is early release. November 24th and 25th is Thanksgiving vacation. There's no school. November 28th is the regular Board of Education meeting at 5:30 p.m. here at the Instructional Planning Center in the arena. December 6th is high school parent-teacher conferences from 5:30 to 8:45. December 7th is early release. December 12th is Board of Education meeting at 5:30 p.m. December 23rd is the parent-teacher comp day. There's no school. And December 26th through the 30th is Christmas break. Again, no school. That brings us to community input. Is there anybody present for community input for an item not on the agenda? I don't see anybody coming forward, so we'll move on to, there are no conflict disclosures also, so we'll move on then to 8, the consent agenda. The superintendent of schools recommends approval of the following: approval and or correction of minutes of previous meetings, consideration and approval of bills, approval and or correction of the financial report, board approval of new hires. We have Dwayne Loffman as a substitute paraeducator, Stacy Ernster as a TAP classroom leader, Vicki Ranney and Tracy Renner as food service satellite workers, Troy Brock as a long-term sub, Kelsey Hill as an assistant director for the fall and spring three-act play, Carol Kapler as a substitute paraeducator, Paula Ramirez in the transportation department as a sped bus aide, Marsha Reedy as an assistant gymnastics coach, and Rhonda Nelson as a substitute paraeducator. There are no contracts or resignations for board approval. There's a renewal for arena advertising for 2017 with American Bank and Trust, Dakota Land, Federal Credit Union, Midco, ProClean Plus, First National Bank, and Elwine Brothers Distributing. And there's a request for approval to donate vintage surplus home economic items to the Pyle House Museum on behalf of the Huron School District. And there's a list of items. Was that list of items included in the board packet?
Yes.
I missed that. Oh, here we go. Okay, with the consent agenda, as always, it can be approved in one motion, or if there's any questions, or if anybody wants something removed, they can do so.
I'd move approval of consent agenda.
Second.
There's a motion and a second for approval of the consent agenda. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed say no. That motion carries. For celebrating successes in the district, normally our superintendent handles this, but he is out sick today. So I will read through them. Congratulations to Clyde Dillman. On November 7th, 2016, he was declared Clyde Dillman Day in Huron. And we thank him for his 49 years of service driving school buses for the Huron School District. Congratulations to the Washington 4-5 Center on receiving a $500 school lunch award for team nutrition from the Healthier U.S. School Challenge. Congratulations to the girls volleyball team for the District 3AA champions. Congratulations to Ty Evers and Sam Kretschmar, seniors at the high school who made the 2016 All-ESD football offensive team. Also congratulations to Nick Christensen and Hyland Heinz, also seniors at the high school who made the 2016 All-ESD football defensive team. Congratulations to Leah Jackson, a kindergarten teacher at the Buchanan K-1 Center, on her marriage to Corey Youngman. And congratulations to Michael Schmitz, head football coach, for being named the Region 3 Coach of the Year, which is voted on by the South Dakota Football Coaches Association. And congratulations to Carissa Schroeder, a senior, Jada Schillingstad, a junior, and Havin Hines, a freshman, who made the 2016 All-ESD volleyball team. And that is our congratulations for today. We'll now move on to reports to the board. Our first report is from the business manager.
Well, all I have this evening is a report on the general fund. We're one-third of the way through the fiscal year. To date, the district has collected $3,488,000 of revenue. That's 19% of what we have budgeted. Last year at this time, we had collected $2,905,000, or 18% of that budget last year. So far this year, we have spent $4,235,000, or 23% of the budget. Last year at this time, we had spent $5,115,000, or 31% of the budget, and that again is the difference because of the way the teacher contracts are being expensed this year. What I would say is the budget, we spent about 8% since last month, which is right on track. Spend about 8% a month. That's my report.
Any questions for our business manager? Seeing none. For the superintendent's report, Mr. Nebelsek did ask me to confirm with the members of the board that we can have our annual lunch with the legislators on December 5th at 11:30. That'll be the first Monday in December, December 5th, at a Monday at 11:30 a.m. This will be at Washington School. We do come into session as an open meeting during that time, and so press is welcome.
Excuse me.
Is there anybody who can't make that they know of?
Are all three legislative members committed to?
That is my understanding. They have all been notified of that, and it is open for them.
Great.
So as long as it works for us, then we'll schedule it for December 5th. Again, it's at 11:30 at Washington School. Then we'll move on to the annual bullying prevention report. And Ms. Hinker's report is presenting this one.
In your packets, you should have some data that was collected from the 2015-16 school year. Each school reports their bullying data on the forms that you see, and then they're compiled into one form to show you the district totals. If you look at the first page, the number of alleged incidents in the district was 31, and then the number of founded incidents was 12. Each alleged incident is researched to see if it's actual bullying, where it's a repeated offense, and then 12 were founded incidents, which include 11 perpetrators and 15 victims. You can see that there were many conferences that took place within the buildings. Some included detention, no suspensions or expulsions. And you can see the area of concern is in the classroom, which is normal for bullying.
Looks like January is the busiest month.
When you look at your second page, it breaks it down into each building for you. You can see that the high school and middle school tends to have more reports of it just due to the age of the children, where Buchanan has the least because they're pretty little yet. And every school also has a plan for a program to prevent bullying. Those plans range from second step in the elementaries. In the middle school, they use second step curriculum as well, and they build that into their STRIPES program. And at the high school, Mr. Radke talks to each class. They really emphasize technology at the high school to prevent that cyberbullying. And then everyone goes through the Title IX compliance.
One question, do you know how the data compares to the previous school year, 2014, 2015, as far as the total number of alleged incidents and number of founded incidents? Are we going up, down, or are we staying about the same?
Actually, this year it was a lot less.
It was less, okay.
Yep. For the number of founded incidents.
Okay.
Why is the classroom the spot where the bullying takes place more frequently?
It's probably the area where you have the adults who are going to be able to see it. It's an area that's more monitored by adults. We all know that bullying takes place in the presence of adults. Kids aren't afraid to do it while adult is present. But in order to be able to see it and catch it, it has to be a more confined area. It's harder to catch it in the lunchroom, you know, where it's just a mass of kids, unless somebody reports it.
That makes sense.
I had a similar question along the lines of Mr. Hayter about looking at a longitudinal study. We've had this bullying policy in place now. I think it was put in place right around the time I came on the board, if not shortly before then. And now might be a good time for the administration to kind of look back and put together some data showing how things have progressed. Is the policy working? Is it not working? Maybe what can be changed on it? This may be a good time to review that policy.
Just going to add, if you had a graph, you know, that, you know, showed a trend line, that'd be helpful to know if you're trending up, trending down, trending the right direction, you know, are we making progress?
Right.
We love our graphs and trend lines. So.
Yeah.
And maybe also show enrollment on there, because as enrollment goes up and we get more kids, you would think it would also go up, so.
And I think your data is going to be a little skewed until you get a couple more years of your elementary buildings, because if you look back too far, you've got K-5 buildings, and you're going to see more incidents of bullying in the upper grades versus the lower grades. And that's just because bullying is a repetitive event, and younger kids are probably not going to do it twice. Tell them once, and it's done.
I think it was interesting to note that total for the year, there were 31 alleged bullying incidents, but only 12 that were founded. So you're about, you know, one in three are actually being found to actually constitute bullying under the policy. And is that more often a situation where the incident either didn't happen, or is it because it didn't fall under the definition of bullying, which requires repeated activity?
Right.
Do you know?
Yeah, that would be the difference. That they perceived it to be bullying, so it was reported, but then when they looked into it, it wasn't a repeated offense.
Because every time there's negative interaction between students, it doesn't automatically constitute bullying.
Right. Has to be repeated.
Any other questions? Well, thank you for stepping in and presenting this for us tonight.
Yes.
Okay, this moves us now into old business. We have the second reading on the conflict disclosure policy. It's the third time now. We've had the introduction, the first reading, and now the second reading, and it is up for approval. Again, this is the policy that is the suggested language from the Associated School Boards. Based upon the current law as it is written. We've been, to my understanding, following this since the law went into effect July 1. This basically just adds in some language into our policy manual, so we have a policy in place on it.
Are there any changes since the first reading?
Not that I'm aware of.
No.
But was that a motion?
I will make a motion to approve it as presented, second reading.
Second.
A motion and a second to approve the policy on conflict disclosure. Is there any further discussion on that motion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed say no? That motion carries. Next, we have a second reading on a procurement guide for federal awards. Again, this has been previously introduced and had a first reading. It is now up for second reading and approval. If I remember correctly, this is just something we have to have in place for grant purposes.
Yes.
Motion to approve.
There's a motion and a second to approve this. Again, this is, we need to have something like this in place because we receive federal grants, so we have to have this type of policy regarding how we do procurement.
There hasn't been any changes since first reading, and
is this something just came down from the federal government then? They decided we had to have some type of a...
Yes.
After all.
It's in the new super circular from the federal government.
There's a motion and a second to approve. Any further discussion? Seeing none, we'll proceed to vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And opposed say no. That motion carries. We'll now move on to new business. First item of new business is the sports improvement change order number G3, in the amount of $146,993.56. I will ask our business manager to go through this with us.
Okay, this should be the last change order on the project. It's made up of three different components, which was RFP1, which we carried from the very beginning of the project, where we tried to lower the cost of the project by taking some of the work out of the contract and doing, just eliminating some of it and doing a lot of it with our own staff. That original RFP1 was at $94,000, $94,348. As you'll see now, it has jumped up to $158,348. That's because the addition of the $64,000 of liquidated damages. So that's where you're going to find your liquidated damages coming off the contract. So RFP1's now worth a reduction of $158,000. And then the other two small ones are actually additions to the contract. The number 14 is $5,000 because when the fence contractor for the tennis court fence said that the posts that were in the spec book were not spec'd heavy enough and wanted to put in heavier posts to hold the 12-foot fence, and that came at an additional cost of $5,000. If you look at that cover letter for RFP14, that shouldn't say electrical subcontractor, that should say fencing subcontractor. Empire Fence and Netting is the fencing subcontractor. So that added $5,000 cost. And then the RFP18, that was at our request to get us a better greens groomer to take care of the turf. We saw the greens groomer that Mid-America Sports Construction had, and we saw the one that was provided to us. And the difference to get one that actually does the job correctly is another $6,000.
Two questions. What is our liquidated damages amount? What's the actual amount?
It was 32 days at $2,000 or $1,000 a day.
Okay.
$2,000 a day, excuse me. $64,000.
Okay. And explain to me what a greens groomer is.
After so many hours of play or practice of use of the artificial turf, you drag this machine around that redistributes the rubber evenly back through the turf and fluffs up the turf.
Is it like
and cleans the surface.
Is it like
so
a big rake?
If there's paper or debris out there, that is picked up.
Okay. Is it like a big rake?
Yeah. You pull it with any sort of ATV or gator. I'm not sure what Rex has been using, but, you know, and it's 4 to 5 feet wide, and you pull it around. And it grooms the field. I think we groomed the field maybe 3 or 4 times this first season. And the activity director, Mr. Roder, he tracks all the hours of usage on the field. And then when we've hit the magic mark, they groom the field.
So who spec'd the first one?
The Coke Hazard.
Coke Hazard.
And, of course, we didn't know any better because this is our first trip with artificial turf, but all the spec book said is provide a sweeper and a groomer.
Okay.
And yeah, it's quite a difference between a low-end sweeper and a groomer and what people that are in the industry use for a sweeper and groomer.
Is this TCA 1400, is that the sweeper?
Yes. Okay. That's a model number of the
sweeper.
The machine we have does it all in one. It's a sweeper and a groomer all at once.
Okay. But it's two separate pieces of equipment.
No, one piece of equipment and it does it all at once.
Well, on this change order, you got a Greens groomer for $2,500 shipment, and then a TCA 1400 for $7,600.
Mm-hmm. Greens groomer's the name.
They delivered us with two cheaper pieces of equipment.
Oh, it's a credit back. I got you. Never mind.
And we had to pay to send them back.
Never mind. I got it.
But they did take them back and give us credit for them.
Okay.
Minus the trucking.
On the damages, there were 32 days. How was that calculated?
That damages ran from August 1st, when it was supposed to be done according to the contract, through right around the first tennis match we had. They got it done on a Saturday morning, and we had the tennis match. So 32 days past August 1st, which was September 2nd or so. They paid the full amount of damages all the way through, even though they had turned over the artificial turf to us in time for the first soccer, or not the first soccer game, but a couple soccer games and the first football game.
So we're... Substantial compliance on the entire project didn't occur until right before that first tennis match. So we're not giving any credit for partial compliance on the stadium side. Okay.
And there was no pushback.
Are we continuing to charge any liquidated damages for what wasn't done on September 2nd? Which was, we still don't have our practice board for tennis and soccer. It may have came in today, but there's questions on whether it's damaged or not. And so it's not installed yet.
The way it reads, it's substantial completion. So we're able to use both facilities by that date. And there really isn't anything in the contract that says if one's done, then you reduce it. It's the project has to be done both facilities.
Right. According to the contract document, we did on the elementary projects end up giving some leniency on some of that. That was a lot more complicated than this project.
And so you said that was included in that RFP 1, and so that number of $158,000 includes that. That's the total reduction that includes the $64,000 and liquidated damages.
Yes. And we have not made final payment yet. We won't make final payment until it's all signed off on and everything's, mainly the practice board is installed and ready to go.
And I should note the number I originally read is actually deduction. This entire change order is actually a reduction in the price. It's not an increase in the price.
So after we deduct this off the price, we are down to where the final payment was going to be around $70,000, which we are holding till it's done.
I'd make a motion to approve change order number G-3.
I'd second it.
There's a motion and a second to approve change order G-3, which will reduce the cost of the project, a sports improvement project, the amount of $146,993.56. Any further discussion on that motion? Seeing none, we'll proceed to vote. All in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed say no. That motion carries. The next is our legislative positions for the ASBSD Delegate Assembly. Because we tend to take a little time walking through those, if there's no objection from the board, I'm going to drop those to the bottom of new business and proceed with the two items that Sherry Nelson is going to present on. No objection, we'll proceed in that matter, so we'll move to the TAP handbook revisions. This is a introduction of these revisions by Sherry Nelson.
Okay, the purpose of this report is to introduce proposed changes to the Tiger After School Program Handbook. The proposed changes can be classified into two categories. The first change, which is the yellow highlighted section in your notes, involves ensuring our sign-out policy matches what we have been doing at TAP. I met with the elementary principals, and we have decided to eliminate the requirement that family and friends authorized to pick up their children must be over the age of 18. This is being recommended because parents already provide us with written authorization of who they allow us to pick up, or who they allow to pick up their children. And we also, if parents provide written documentation, currently allow children to walk home alone. And so we felt that the over age 18 was a bit much. The remaining changes all involve additions to the TAP handbook due to federal requirements and updates that have recently come into effect. And you'll see them listed there in the green highlighted sections. So in summary, the proposed revisions are being recommended to match our current sign-up procedures and to meet new federal requirements and updates. Are there any questions?
Any questions?
Move approval.
Well, I believe the
this is introduction.
It's actually introduction. We'll do a normal policy process. We'll do an introduction, first and second reading.
You can do that next month, Garrett.
So,
or John did. Sorry. Wrong
so
guy.
We can approve this sometime in January.
After I sleep on it, maybe I don't want to make a motion.
So, I guess this is our first meeting, so we can approve it in December. Thank you very much for introducing that. We'll move right on then to social studies adoption timeline. This is an informational report from Sherry Nelson.
Okay, this is my first curriculum adoption, and so I thought I would run by you my proposed timeline for the Huron School District social studies curriculum adoption. So this fits under the district goal of staff development, specifically talking about collaboration, improving effectiveness of teacher collaboration, and adequate training, keeping the Board of Education informed on all professional development, and also accountability for administrators to know and adhere to board policy. The Huron School District has a predetermined cycle for curriculum adoption. This year, the district is reviewing social studies curriculum that will be implemented during the 2017-2018 school year. Using board policies IIAA and IIAA1 and IFN as a guide, I'm recommending the following timeline. And you can see it listed in your handout and on the screen. In September, we asked teachers for companies that they would like to see textbook samples from, and those have been delivered to the Office of Curriculum and Instruction. During October, teachers K through 12 have been working on selecting priority standards, and priority standards are what every student must know, understand, and be able to do in relationship to the social studies standards. They've also been working on developing scope and sequences and are currently writing proficiency scales, which will determine the evidence that teachers need to determine mastery. This is something new to our district, and we are doing it so that teachers are better informed as to the standards that they're teaching and what evidence they're looking for, so that when they go shopping for curriculum materials, they will keep their priority standards in mind. In November, my plan is for staff to preview textbook samples, form curriculum committees, and hear vendor presentations. In January, to line up vendor presentations, and then in January they would listen to the vendor presentations and we would get an estimate to the business office. In March, we would take that teacher committee and add to it people from the community, including students and parents, and then I would be submitting recommendations to the board in March for textbook materials and try to schedule some vendor professional development yet that spring. If possible in May then, if the vendors are available and we have purchased or been given curriculum development, professional development training, we would try to line that up and we would form some curriculum development committees. And then in June, my plan is that we would vertically align those K-12 priority standards in social studies, collaboratively design common and summative and formative assessments, and begin working on unit lesson plans. And again, the work in June is something new as far as vertical alignment K-12 and working collaboratively on common assessments. Then in fall of 2017, teachers would implement the aligned curriculum and purchased social studies materials. The cost to the district would be the purchase of the approved social studies materials and the summer curriculum development work. So my recommendation is that I'm sharing this timeline with you to keep you informed as to this year's curriculum adoption plans. Questions?
I have one. I was kind of involved in the 90s when we wrote the curriculum textbook adoption, and one of my concerns just kind of looking at the timeline is the way we had understood it would be is that you would have a committee that would be with a majority membership consisting of classroom teachers, but that full committee would review the different textbooks so that we wouldn't have, like we had with the science textbooks, where the teachers had decided we want this textbook, and then the committee really didn't review the textbooks or review the process and didn't see the presentations on it. So that would be my concern as look at that. I don't know what the intent of is the review staff textbook selections by public committee. I think the committee is supposed to be classroom teachers as the majority of the committee, and that as a committee with the input from the public, they should review all the information that they have, whether it be the presentations from the vendors or the textbooks that are being considered, not just one recommendation from the staff committee. So.
Okay. As I looked through the policy, it does mention that advisory groups should seek advice and gather input from community representatives. It didn't really say at what point in the policy, I didn't feel, but maybe you can help me determine if they need to be on all the presentations and all the selections or informed at some point.
Well, what I wouldn't want to see is, you know, of course, and I know that the science textbook part of it, we ran into some other issues and that kind of came up after the fact. I wouldn't want to see a situation where the textbook has been decided and nobody actually reviews all the textbooks that they consider. Doesn't have a chance to look at the material.
Okay.
And I had a similar question as to when the public or community becomes more formally involved, and I think maybe there's some drafting question, because it talks about I'm looking at IIAA also, in that third paragraph, it talks about committees established by the director of instruction with a majority membership consisting of classroom teachers. But then it talks about these advisory groups. And so I don't know if those committees and the advisory groups are the same. And those advisory groups should seek advice and input from community representatives. So does the committee established by the director of instruction have to include members of the public? I don't think there's a requirement. As I read this, I think it can be interpreted to say that it's not a requirement, that it has to be, just has to be a majority of classroom teachers. But on the other side, why would you include a requirement of majority classroom teachers if it wasn't intended to have some public input far earlier on in the process? So I don't know if we need to give any specific guidance, but.
I would just say, you know, school board writes policy as far as the administration of the policy and the the way you administer that policy and the rules that you follow to do that are up to the administration to do that. I would just say the same thing. If you're wanting to have a committee with a majority of classroom teachers, it wouldn't make a lot of sense to have one committee with all classroom teachers, then turn around and have another committee with a majority of classroom teachers. You think you'd want one committee, is what I'm saying.
And I thought about what you said. I sat in on some of the science curriculum adoption, and with all the different presentations, some of them did webinars, some of them came in live, and we had to pull together quickly people to be able to sit and listen to them. So that got spread out over a variety of months. I'm not sure that the committee from the community could necessarily make all of those presentations. But I do see the value in letting them look at all the materials prior to the selection. Some school districts have a room set up, a public room set up of textbooks for community members to come in and look at if they're interested. Would that be something that would appeal at the beginning of the process?
I think something along those lines or something else to get a little more input earlier on in the process, because I think I would have the same concern as Mr. Hayter, that it seems like the selection process will be done mm-hmm. by the time it goes to that public committee, and then they're not going to be given really much of a choice. It's either approve this or send them all the way back to the beginning of the process and not having seen any of the other vendor selections. So I also understand the process, the problem though of if you have some parents who are involved and they need to sit in a webinar at 11:30, you know, on a Monday, can they get to that? So practically, can they be involved in the vendor process?
Okay.
So I don't know where that medium is between getting input and...
What if we were to...
Be flexible.
In October, it says form staff curriculum committees. What if we just change that to... to curriculum committees involving the public as well, and then we invite the committee members to the vendor presentations, and if they can make it, great, and if they can't, they've had the opportunity anyway to be able to share with that work.
They will at least have got that opportunity to give their input up front before you start going through textbooks and things that they think are important.
So what I'll do is I'll just move that March where it talks about the public committee, and we will just make that a staff and public curriculum committee in November. Would that work?
I think that would. I just, again, trying to read through the policy and implement it here as you have. I don't know how you envision that if you, I guess let me ask you, is this one committee or is it a committee based upon, is there a different committee for each building?
There would be a different committee for each building.
And so would that committee be able to go to its parent-teacher organization and say, hey, does there one nominee who wants to come in and be the parent representative on this board? And then, so you have one, at least one or two parents who are on the committee from the beginning, and then later on in the process, they'll go back to the full parent advisory group where it talks about seeking input and gathering information from those individuals. I guess I'm just kind of brainstorming here as mm-hmm. to... process of getting parent involved.
I think I'll probably just ask the building principals to select the parents or ask the parents. They can provide me with the names they would know better than I would, who would be good for their building.
I think the question's raised because when we did science, nobody could give us a concrete answer on when the community was brought into the process. So I think we left mm-hmm. with the thought that the community wasn't involved. And it's clear that they should seek advice from students and parent groups. And after that, then the director of instruction makes a recommendation. Mm-hmm. So they'd have to be before you're prepared to come to the superintendent and say, this is what we should order.
Yes. All right, well, that's helpful. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And again, this was just their informational report to us and not seeking any action at this time. So. Okay, and then Our last item of new business is the ASBSD legislative positions. So this is where we annually go through the standing positions and legislative resolutions from the Associated School Boards that have been proposed and are in your board packet, and just kind of walk through them and give a general thoughts on this. And Mr. Bischoff is our delegate to the assembly, so he is our voting representative, and he can take our voice to that body. I would suggest we start with the standing positions. Is that, since they are a little broader in scope?
Standing positions, that's the...
Okay. Yeah, that's a shorter one.
It's a shorter one, yeah. Okay. But it's, I think, designed to be more broad overview of policy and not the more specific resolutions. So we'll just go through these, and I'm just going to touch on the edited ones. And if at any point you want to stop or have any thoughts on something that's not edited, stop me, but I don't intend on going through each one of them unless they have some sort of editing mark from the Associated School Boards. So first, under student achievement, there appears to be some minor editing involved here. I can't see how it touches on content, so does anybody have any questions or thoughts on the student achievement standing position?
Okay with that one.
Okay. Okay, we'll move on to Native American Indian education. There's some extensive revision of this portion. And I got some thoughts on it before I launch into them. I'll see if anybody else. My biggest problem with this section is that it appears to insert the word Native in front of American Indian, and then creates a word Native American Indian, which I've never seen it referred to that way.
It's either
American
Indian too, yeah.
Or Native American, not Native American Indian.
Yeah, I would agree.
And so I would highly suggest that some of that be brought up, and maybe they're intending to switch from the term American Indian to Native American and didn't edit this document properly. But if they are intending to put the word Native American Indian into all these documents, it just, that seemed to be not common.
Sense.
Yeah, it doesn't make much sense. So. Okay, I was also going to be just going to raise a general concern. In kind of the middle paragraph, they add some language in here to reference the Native American Achievement Schools Grant Program and the Paraprofessional Tuition Assistance Scholarship Program. I kind of have some concern about adding in specific programs that they want to mention at this particular time into a standing position. These are supposed to be more broad policy topics and not specific program references, I guess. That's just a premise on my part. I'm not specifically against these programs. I don't really know anything about them, but.
Yeah, that paraprofessional tuition assistance was one that passed the legislature last year.
Okay.
It gave basically education assistance to people that wanted to work in those positions mainly on the reservations.
Okay.
The student population had to be 50% Native American.
Wouldn't
qualify
hurt.
For those programs.
It wouldn't hurt to reach out to Jerry Kaufman or Wade Pogany and question that before Garrett goes.
As to why those particular programs are mentioned in there?
I mean, if you got those questions, that's what I'd do, is I'd email both those guys, and they should be able to explain it. The board put this together.
The Associated School Boards.
Right.
Board.
And that governing board.
So as I was reading through that particular section, I didn't understand a lot of the reasons for the changes, so I was going to put a big no on that one.
For you. Garrett questioned that language and if they're willing to change some of it.
Yeah.
And why it's inserted in there is a good question.
Yeah. Any other discussion on the Native American Indian education topic? Okay. There's no changes to health and wellness position. There's no changes in technology and education. No changes in local governance. No changes in school reorganization. There's a reference to an edited title in public school choice, but I don't see any actual marking for a title change. I don't know what that is. So I'll move on to open government and transparency. Anybody have any thoughts on this?
I think this one came about because of some disruptions that were occurring at some public meetings elsewhere in the state, with people recording them and the government entities not liking that.
Ours are televised already, so from our standpoint, it probably wouldn't matter too much.
Yeah, I know there was some public disagreement over whether a member of the public could, on their own,
use a camera
to record a meeting, and obviously we don't have any problem with that here. So I assume that is why that was inserted there, to respectfully record a board meeting, that we support generally that right to observe and to respectfully record a board meeting. So if a member of the public wanted to sit in our meeting and record, as long as they're being respectful, we're not going to have a problem. I do have a problem with the addition of the language "and potential legislation," just because I don't know what that potential legislation is. So I have a hard time supporting something I don't know what it says. I do support the current state policies regarding the local option to post official minutes and public notices, but I don't know why they're asking us to support potential legislation. So that's my thoughts.
They're being transparent.
They're trying to be transparent? Well, I guess so, but yeah, let us know what this potential legislation is that we're being asked to support. Any other
comments? You think they should take the word "potential" out of there and just put "and legislation"?
I would just the recommendation is to insert the words "and potential legislation" after ASBSD supports state policies, and I don't think they need to insert those three words at all.
Okay, I would agree with that.
Yeah, I would too.
If they want us to support legislation, we need to see what the legislation is. Anything else on that topic? Seeing no more, school finance then is the next one.
Kelly, do you see any problem with that one? I mean, you've seen that school finance. Wonder if you'd have any thought on judicious funding and within the mandates and parameters of each fund.
I don't know why we have to insert them words, but it's the same general idea that this past legislature took out the protections with the two-year averaging on your enrollment for state aid purposes. They pay you for what you actually have. So schools that are experiencing declining enrollment can experience a declining state aid in a situation where they already have teachers under contract for the year. So.
And that specific issue is actually addressed in the resolutions.
Yeah, in the legislative position.
And so I read this and I just couldn't understand why they needed to add this particular language in. It did not seem to clarify the standing position to me in any way. But it doesn't seem to hurt it either. Sometimes I just wonder if they're making changes to make changes.
Are you taking all of David's notes?
I always have thoughts, so you're going to hear them. Okay, anything else on that topic? Okay, moving on to safe and secure schools, no changes there. There's investment in education. They were deleting two sections regarding supporting new alternative funding sources and deleting a section on trusting locally elected boards to allocate new investments in education. I'm guessing those are being removed because of the funding formula that passed in the last legislative session.
That'd be my guess.
Any other thoughts on that section?
It's okay.
Okay, any other thoughts in general on the standing positions before we move on that we missed in the cover? Okay, we'll move on to then the legislative resolutions. These are the more detailed, more policy-specific resolutions. We'll kind of go down in the same order. Under achievement and equity. There's no changes in the pre-kindergarten standards or professional development or compulsory school attendance.
Last year, we came out as a no on this one, and I haven't changed my position on this. I've had this conversation many times with our superintendent. We've discussed what happened when the age went from 16 to 18, when these kids were drop out at 16. A lot of them would find out in short order that the grass wasn't greener on the other side, and they'd come back to school. And now if they're waiting till they're 18, they're probably a lot of credits behind by that point, and they drop out at 18, they're unlikely to return. And we've lost them. And that was the main reason. I think we were probably in the minority there, Garrett, weren't we on that one? Yeah. But that's what we sent you with last year. I would still be a no on that one. But
they haven't proposed any change into it, so
no.
If we want to do something, we have to actually affirmatively request a change. And I don't know if that's a...
I would propose a change to 16.
I've done it the past couple of years.
So yeah.
Does it get any shot now? Does it get any support out there? So we're just a lone wolf out there trying.
Okay, well, I can't believe others don't.
One of these years, the whole state's going to say, "Wouldn't it be best to go back to 16?"
Right. Mm-hmm. We'll say we've been fighting for that for years. Mm-hmm. So. Okay. Well, we love sending Garrett out there to
get beat up on.
Get beat up on, yeah, that's right. Fight some losing battles for
Stand
us.
Stand firm.
So. Okay, and then moving on to number four. Some significant editing here on the academic standards resolution.
Does anybody know why they're lining out Common Core everywhere? Is it because it's gotten a bad rap in some parts of the press, the term, or? I don't know if the language has been changed. There's still Common Core standards.
Well, yeah, this doesn't actually change any of the standards.
No,
this
it doesn't.
It says, like, but I'm actually in favor of this change because after seeing the science standards, which aligned, they weren't actually the Common Core standards, but they took them almost word for word. I think the Common Core standards they use for science are a little bit too much biased toward global warming, and the evolutionary content has some bias in it that I don't feel is good in those standards. So I'm fine with doing away with the alignment with Common Core, and while they're at it, take the Smarter Balance Assessment with it.
Well, I wondered if it part of the language change isn't because South Dakota only utilizes a Common Core in reading and math.
And I think that may be part of it, is that the term Common Core only applies to some very specific standards that were implemented by the National Governors Association and the Chief State School Officers Organization.
Their education secretary.
Yeah. Yeah. And that was content standards for only English and math. And it doesn't. There actually is no Common Core standards for science or social studies or anything else. There was a nationally produced standards for science, like the Next Generation Science Standard, yep. But it was a different organization that...
They called them Common Core, even though it wasn't really part of Common Core, per se.
Yeah, and I think there was... but I think that caused some confusion as to who actually was putting out these standards. And so maybe that's what they're doing, is they're just getting rid of the reference to Common Core because it doesn't actually describe what is going on. And South Dakota does not use those standards. South Dakota didn't just wholesale adopt the science standards, although they did copy most of them. They did go through their own process, and I assume when they do social studies, they'll do that same thing. There aren't any Common Core type academic standards that I'm aware of for social studies.
There are, actually, because I have this Common Core, all the standards here. There are history and science ones.
South Dakota did not
adopt those.
They must be from different organizations, though, because I know that the National Governors Association that put out those original Common Core standards did not touch anything else.
It's only got for history, 6th through 12th grade, and...
You're right on the science standards, but the ones that were put out by, I'm trying to make it the organization you said,
It was the National Governors Association in conjunction with, like, the Council of school office, chief school officers, basically your national organization for secretaries of education.
And I think one of the problems is when you get into history standards, for example, even if you did try to put a Common Core across the country, what they want in California compared to what they want in South Dakota are going to be on opposite ends of the spectrum, and to come up with a Common Core between those two areas is going to be really tough.
Yeah. And I think that was part of the reason why they stuck the original Common Core only to math and reading, is because it's hard to determine a separate math curriculum that you'd have in California than one's South Dakota, or even reading. The level of English ability should be the same everywhere. Whereas in social studies, you're more likely to find some more variation based upon what particular communities want to emphasize. So getting back to this, this is a change in the legislative resolution as to what ASBSD supports regarding how we vocalize that support, and it's just getting rid of reference to Common Core, and it's just talking about, do we support South Dakota academic content standards?
Sounds good to me.
It sounds like we're yes.
So we're all good on that one?
Okay. Then moving on, extra and co-curricular activities, no change there. Six, school employee compensation. This appears to me to be changes based upon the fact that the school funding formula passed.
Yep.
So anybody have any questions about that change?
One question on that, as I read that, it says extracurricular and co-curricular activities, that there wouldn't be any fee. Well, what about musical instruments, shirts, that type of thing? Like with our music program, they buy shirts to participate in the middle school music. Band instruments, of course, they have to purchase or rent. Are they trying to address that, or are they saying that's okay?
I don't know. I guess it just says that ASBSD supports extra and co-curricular activities and opposes legislation that in any way establishes a fee for participation. And so I don't know if they, at one point there was some push in the state legislature to impose some fees. I don't know.
I think I know what they're after and probably fine with it. I'm just thinking maybe they should, when they say in any way establish fees, then you know, obviously you have to have an instrument or you have to have a shirt or whatever. So for
yeah,
some of the programs.
Set up locally.
Yeah.
Huh? Those fees are set up to localize.
They are. Yeah.
This is addressing legislative measures that would establish fees for participation.
Okay.
That's how I interpret it, Kerwin.
I would too, that this is meant to talk to the legislature and not our local decisions.
Okay. I don't think there's been any move to do away with buying band instruments and that type of thing. So I guess I'm fine with it.
We're moving on then to B, local governance. The first one appears to me that they are just changing the phrase public school exemption to alternative instruction, which everybody actually commonly refers to as homeschool.
Wait a minute, can you go back? Isn't there one for achievement and equity?
School employee.
Yeah, six. Sorry, we went to that one and I didn't hear any question. I guess if you want to go back to A6.
No, I'm fine with that.
Okay.
Sorry, I missed that.
Okay, back to B1. Students receiving alternative instruction. Well, they actually do have homeschool instruction in print. I don't see any change in the actual substance.
What?
Any questions or comments on that?
I guess I'd have a little bit of a concern in that they said, and the establishment of effective state regulation to ensure exempt students receive a high quality education. I guess they aren't changing it from before, so that's probably not a big change. I just know that from a standpoint of homeschool students, it looks like when you look at standardized testing, you're not really seeing a big issue there as far as overall. So I don't know if they may be trying to address a problem that at this point really isn't a big issue. But I'm okay. The only changes they're making are to progress of students. They're changing it from alternative instructions from public school exemption. That's really all they're changing, right?
Yeah.
I can live with it.
Seems to be just terminology and not substance.
Okay.
Okay, then school finances, no change. Charter schools, no change.
Charter schools, the only one I would say there is I know that's been in there for a while. I'm not as concerned about charter schools. In some states, they've shown to have some positive effect, and I know there's argument about whether that's true or not, but I think if you look at the data, in some cases they have done okay. So I'm not afraid of the competition that charter schools would create as long as they're public schools, personally.
Do we even have any charter schools in South Dakota? Does anyone
only
know?
Only on the Indian Reservation.
I think the inclusion of the charter schools legislation is okay. From the research that I've done on them, they can tend to lead to corrupt as far as a leader of a specific business who then later funds a school. Well, if she's in charge of her business, who funds that school, and then she's in charge of the school. A lot of them have also been found to lie about attendance rates in order to gain funding. So I think the legislation is probably okay to keep in there. Not that I think that would be a huge problem in South Dakota, but
And so that would align right with what this is saying, is that the Associated School Board's position is to oppose any legislation that would create charter schools in South Dakota beyond what is currently authorized, which is just a pilot school, pilot charter school for American Indian students. So. Any other comments on the charter school resolution? Okay, moving on to B4, public funding for non-public education. It's just, again, I think only edited to change it to reference the fact that we have adopted a new funding form. Sounds good? Okay. Now, next, school boundaries. They're deleting this entire resolution regarding minor boundary changes.
Something passed on this regard in the last session. Is that why this is being eliminated? I can't recall.
Yeah, the new law went into effect July 1.
That's what I thought, yeah.
Okay.
So the new law, the current law was repealed, so I suppose they figure they have accomplished this.
Yeah.
I would be okay with the second part of that the contributions to the scholarship funds to become public information from the means of transparency. I guess I'm not in favor of changing the current law. Otherwise, I don't really see any need to.
Are you on 5 or are you on 6?
6. I'm on 6. You're on which one?
We're still on 5.
Sorry.
Anybody else on 5? Okay. Then on 6. So this is a resolution opposing using state tax credits for insurance companies to fund private school scholarships. And this was passed at the last legislative session.
It already passed. This is already in law.
Yes.
Yeah. That's so why they're trying to have that law overturned, basically. And I guess I'd be okay with what they say in the rationale on the second part, where they say they support amending SB 159 to require contributions to the scholarship fund to become public information, means of transparency. I would favor that part. Trying to reverse the law, I don't really see any real issue with the law.
I have the personal belief that I think the law is not constitutional, that our state constitution has some specific language about not allowing state funding of private schools, and it's pretty broadly worded. And I think even though they try and route it through, you know, if the insurance company gives money to a school, then they get a tax credit. I mean, it's still clearly state dollars that are being spent on it. So I think there's some constitutional issues on it, but
and that would go through the courts if that is challenged, I suppose.
I would assume it's whenever it finally gets implemented, which I don't think it has yet.
I don't think any insurance companies have set any up yet.
I would guess it'll probably get challenged at some point.
This was part of that. Well, that was a compromise piece of getting the half penny sales tax.
I think there was some of that too.
Some people over by putting that piece of legislation through.
So, This is a brand new resolution opposing though that program of using tax credits to fund private school scholarships. How do we want to tell Garrett to do on this? I am in favor of that proposed language.
I'm only in favor of the part on public disclosure, public information from the, we need to go down that road on changing the law.
I'd probably leave it as it's written, and we'll see how the chips fall on that one. It's mm-hmm. still fairly new, and
would you be, okay, I guess, would you tell Garrett to vote for adopting that resolution?
Yes.
Okay,
yeah, not in favor of two, so.
Okay, there you go. We're moving on then. School district identification symbols. This is a new resolution that says ASBSD supports the local control by school boards and encourages them to seek input from community stakeholders on matters that involve symbols and events they believe uniquely identify their school. So this is basically in favor of local control on dealing with mascots, and encouraging school boards to discuss with their Native American tribes or community organizations that have concerns about mascots.
Or when the animal rights people come after us.
Yeah. So it's basically in support of local control.
I would favor that.
Yeah.
Everybody good with that?
Good.
Okay. Moving on. This is also another new resolution, use of bathroom, locker room, and other facilities. The resolution reads that ASBSD supports the judgment and integrity of local school board members and school districts to develop a policy which best fits their students, school, and community, that shows respect for all students, staff, and other individuals, including using bathrooms, locker rooms, and other facilities. So this is obviously the last legislative session. As it says in the rationale, the governor vetoed House Bill 1008. It's likely to come up again this year. And so this is a resolution, again, I think, in favor of local control.
Hey, my concern with that, the whole situation, we talked about this last year at great length, is that if you leave it up to each school district, and school districts assume that they don't all do the same thing, because they probably won't, so when you have co-curricular activities between schools, you're going to run into conflict. Second part of that is if a school board takes an action, they are leaving themselves open to a potential lawsuit. If the state takes action, state can handle the lawsuit. You know, it's not going to be local school districts being sued. So I think for conformity around the state, it's better to address this at the state level in this case rather than at the local level, because of the potential for lawsuits and litigation and variation between schools that could cause confusion. And I'm not saying it's a big issue here. I'm not saying it is in our school, but I could certainly see where different school districts are going to have different policies that conflict with each other.
You know if any school districts have tackled this? Because it right now it basically is local control right now, or is this in, I mean, I haven't really heard much since the governor vetoed it, you know, in the last,
I don't know,
since all that fallout happened.
There hasn't been any public discussion of formal policies, but I think every school district deals with this as it comes up. Sure. And,
isn't there one school district out there that actually took a stand? I don't recall.
That's what they're asking here to do, is for local schools to develop a policy.
Last fall, I was against the 1008 and in favor of local control. And although I understand the concern about when you have students traveling, I think the chances of that causing an issue are, you have to have a student who is transgender, who is then involved in a sport, who then travels to another school, and the incidents of that happening are pretty small, and I don't know if that's enough to justify state legislation on the topic. So that's why I think I favor local control on that.
Also, to add what you said, I feel like adding a state legislation might be unnecessarily discriminant against those people who may come out as that, as in, I don't know if any of you here can think of the last time we actually tried to purposely allow a segregation of bathrooms. That didn't work out very well. And I feel like adding state control onto where it might not be an issue would, again, just be unnecessarily discriminant to those people who may or may not identify as that.
I guess what I'm saying is, I'm not saying that we should put a policy in there that says the state should do this. I'm saying we shouldn't have one that tells the local school district to put a policy in place, because they will be open to litigation if they do it.
Right. So it should say instead that the local school districts handle the situation if they have a situation, not necessarily develop a policy to handle the situation.
That would be good. Yeah, that sounds good.
Yeah. So to the extent that it would read that it's in favor of requiring policies, we don't want to do that. So, any other discussion on that topic? Okay. Moving on then to 9. This is a new resolution regarding legal and financial protection for compliance with state law. The resolution reads, ASBSD supports a provision in law that would require South Dakota Attorney General's office to represent a public school district should it face a lawsuit while complying with the state law, and identify the school district for any and indemnify the school district for any financial liability incurred by the district rising out of the lawsuit. I agree with that.
Does anybody know why this one came out? Is that related to the same one?
I absolutely think it's related to the same issue.
That's what I thought.
So we want to make sure that if a state law is passed that requires segregation of bathrooms, that we don't get sued for it. Or if we do get sued for it, they're going to pay for it.
General's going to represent us.
I won't quibble over some of my grammatical questions, but. So we are all in favor of that one, or anybody else? Not in favor, okay. Number 10, 4-day school week referral. This is a new resolution that would read, ASBSD supports potential legislation allowing only school boards to refer a decision on the district implementing or repealing a 4-day school week to voters.
I'm trying to understand that one. What are they saying there?
How is it handled now?
Maybe they have no way to handle it.
I'm wondering, is it possible for the public to initiate a vote on a 4-day school week without ever having gone through the school board?
I don't think so. I would guess this came about a district was implementing 4 days or wanted to come out of 4 days, and they didn't refer to a public vote, and the public wasn't happy about the decision.
But the way this resolution is written is that it would limit the ability to refer a decision on 4-day school weeks to the school board. And so only the school board could decide if the public gets to vote on the question.
See, I don't like that, because I do think any decision that falls within a certain guidelines can be referred. And I don't know why you would make this particular decision different than a different decision.
Yeah. I'd agree with that.
Yeah, and
I would concur with that. I just wonder why this one came about it. There was obviously a situation in some district, and I don't know what that was.
Yeah, and the rationale they provided did not really elucidate the question there. I mean, it just...
Maybe it got referred by the voters and got dinged down, and the school board didn't...
Did it like it? I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. So,
I would assume...
I think we're knowing that one mainly because we don't understand why it's even an issue. Okay, moving on to school finance. School funding. This one is significant editing, obviously because of the new funding formula that was passed.
I'm generally okay with it, I think, unless there's something I'm missing.
Yeah, I mean, basically, I think this kind of adopts what we currently have in place.
Yeah.
Supports the new program. Mm-hmm. Okay, so unless anybody says anything, we'll assume we're good with that one. Two, education service agencies, no change.
What is, supports the reinstatement of full funding, what are the, I had a question, what, education service agencies, what is that?
I'm going to ask our business manager to field that question.
I don't know if I'm the one to field that question about education service agencies. The thing was they cut them a couple years or more ago. They cut the full funding for them, and ASBSD is supporting refunding them in full. They provide services to schools, and I know we took advantage of some of them, but I can't speak in detail.
They've helped us within services, presents different things. They help with when the middle school is going through their requirements for when their test scores were low. Brought in some people from ESA to help with that process. And they just, there's support we can go to. I think there's several regions that cover the state.
I suppose it's a part of the pie, though. What do you want more into school funding? Do you want it there? Or, yeah, I don't know. Like I said, I don't know how much it is.
Yeah.
How much they're talking that was cut from there.
Any further discussion on that one? Move on to three, consistent sparsity funding. No change on that. Okay, they are then deleting the next few on use of capital outlay funds, other revenue, capital outlay growth limitation, 3% index factor. Those are all going away.
I have concerns on number six going away.
Are they added into one?
Oh, they took that out, yeah. Well, they have limited the growth on it, but we, in some ways, we would like to not have that growth limited, right?
Right. That's we oppose legislation that freezes or limits growth of capital outlay. Well, now they have limited the growth of capital outlay, and now we're not going to oppose it. It's not going to have a big immediate effect on us if our capital outlay fund growth slows. Like this year, it was slowed to less than 1%. On an average of the last 10 years, it's been 7%.
Yeah.
But 10 or 20 years from now, when you're trying to keep up your infrastructure and you've had no growth for 10 or 20 years, I think it's going to catch up with us at some point in the future.
Yeah, I think I would oppose taking that out.
Mm-hmm. I think we should we should want to leave that in, even if it's reworded a little different, because I guess to say that opposes legislation, well, the legislation's already happened, so it would have to be opposes legislation.
That was another piece of that puzzle.
Yeah. It was.
Yeah. My guess, they probably took it out because they must feel the battle was lost on it, and it's not going to go backwards to where they're not. It's unlikely they'll lift the limit they placed on it. So it's maybe one of those where they want to pick their battles, but I would agree that
further limiting.
Yeah. So, you want to mention that we want something continue to say we don't want any further limitation, or we do in fact oppose those limits?
Sounds good. Seems like the position of the Associate School Boards is we got the half penny, so let's not talk money this year.
That's what it appears to me. A lot of these do appear to say,
let's let it ride for a year, let's not hound, let's not complain, let's just let it ride.
Yes. We got a good chunk last year, and we're not going to make too much waves this year. Except, coming in number four, a new resolution on two-year enrollment averaging. So this would be a new resolution that says ASBSD supports reinstating two-year enrollment averaging in place of the fall enrollment count for the state aid formula calculation. So, for those following along at home, our funding for the year is based upon count day towards the end of September, and whatever it is that day sets the formula for that year, And if we have fluctuations up or down, we don't know about it until after the school years began. And so this would then create a two-year average. So at least if we have a decrease in student population, it doesn't cause a drastic decrease in our funding, which would then cause us to have to cut staff all of a sudden or shift around resources in the middle of the school year. So at least tries to cause some of the
ups and stabilize
ups and downs. Yeah, help stabilize. But it does cause some money. It's going to cost money. So. And this was one of those things that was specifically kind of at the last minute taken out of the last package, or it was in there in the beginning and then got taken out kind of at the last minute. So we're all in favor of that one? Okay. Sales tax revenue, this is D1. I don't know if this is it changing anything substantively. I think it's more along the lines of we're in favor of what happened last year.
Keeping it in place, basically.
Yeah. Yep. E1, continuing contract, no change there. 2, human resource management, no change there. F1, unfunded mandates. 1, state education mandates, no change there. 2, federal mandates. Yep. Okay. Next, G1, deleting the resolution in favor of reauthorization of the Elementary Secondary Education Act, because it was in fact reauthorized last year. Let's see here. Medicaid service reimbursement, no change. 3, school nutrition, edited. I am opposed to striking out that first sentence.
Yeah, I would be too. Hopefully we can get that corrected now, or something can be done finally.
I think we'd still need to re-examine the Healthy and Hunger Free Kids Act because of the...
I think they're supporting flexibility.
I think there should be some... Maybe nobody disagrees with that there should be some flexibility in the federal law. And I guess whether we kept the first part or not, if we kept the first part, I guess I'm not opposed to keeping that. I'm just thinking there should be flexibility in the law, so we have a little more latitude on what we can serve locally.
Yeah. I'd like to keep in there the fact that we referenced that we don't like that particular statute, or that it's too restrictive. But that's just me.
I'd be okay with keeping it. Okay.
I'd like to keep it. Yeah, the lined out part, and I like the second paragraph too.
Yep. Okay, 4, E-rate, no change. 5, new resolution on the Every Student Succeeds Act, which was the reauthorization of the federal schools program. The resolution reads, ASBSD supports the federal education policy, emphasizing the importance of local governance, providing states with more control over education standards, and strengthening support for local control and managing school administration, budget development, and related operations for school district responsibilities. Sounds like a resolution generally in favor of the Every Student Succeeds Act. I don't see a reason why not. Anybody opposed to that? Okay. Any questions from you, Garrett? Okay. Then that concludes our business portion. I'll entertain a motion. And I'll note that we're going into executive session. There'll be no action taken afterwards. I'll entertain a motion to go into executive session under SECL 1-25-2, subparagraph 1, for discussing the qualifications, competence, performance, character, or fitness of any public officer or employee.
So moved. Second.
A motion and a second to go into executive session. Any discussion? Seeing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed say nay. The motion carries, and we'll take a brief recess and then reassemble in executive session.